Hey, what's up guys? Welcome to Cert Bros. In this video, we're going to be looking at Ftp. Ftp stands for File Transfer Protocol, and it does pretty much what it says on the tin. It's a protocol used to transfer files across a network. Ftp uses a client-server model. The server hosts the files, and the client can connect, download files, upload files, delete, rename, etc. Now, depending on your age, you may have used Ftp already. It was quite popular to download files from friends, download software, drivers, etc. These days, you don't see Ftp used too often, but it is still used in specific cases like in network management and web development. There are a few ways you can access an Ftp server. The first way is through a browser. You can simply type in the Ftp server address. For example, ftp://192.168.0.8. The ftp:// tells our computer to connect to the Ftp port and not the HTTP or HTTPS port. As you can see, an Ftp server is pretty basic, and this may even look familiar to a few of you. It's just a list of files and directories. Now, another way we can connect to an Ftp server is via the Windows File Explorer. Again, we just need to type in the address into the bar at the top of the screen. The third and most popular way to access an Ftp server is via an Ftp client. I'm using probably the most popular one, which is FileZilla. We just need to type in the Ftp details at the top. The last two methods logged us in without any user credentials. Ftp gives us the option to log in as a user or anonymously. This time, we are going to log in as a user by entering the host address, username and password, and also I'll specify the Ftp port number, which is 21. Now, we are warned about this Ftp server not using something called TLS. This is something we'll cover shortly. Once we connect, again, we can browse directories, download and upload files. Because I logged on as a user, I now have permission to view the home directory and all of its content. I can also view the Ftp folder that we already saw, and I'll go ahead and download the file. Now, just a quick note here, Ftp server permissions depend on the server itself, and this is just how I've set mine up, so each one could be different. Now that file has downloaded, I can confirm by showing the desktop, and yes, there it is. Now you've seen Ftp in action, let's talk about some of the more technical details. Ftp uses Transport Protocol TCP. So like any other TCP protocol, the connection starts with a three-way handshake. The client will send a SYN message. The server will respond with a SYNACK. And finally, the client will send an ACK. Now, if this process looks unfamiliar to you, I have another video showing how this works in a bit more detail. That video is called TCP versus UDP, and it's worth having a look. Once we have completed our handshake, we now have an open connection to the Ftp server. Ftp uses two different connections. The first one is the control connection. The control connection handles all of the Ftp commands and instructions, such as GET and PUT commands. Our client will connect to the Ftp server with a destination port of 21 and a randomly selected dynamic source port. So when we want to start transferring files, a new connection is opened. This is called a data connection. Now, there are two different types of data connections. The first type is an active data connection. The way an active data connection is established is by the server initiating the session. It does this from a source port of 20, and it uses a randomly generated dynamic destination port. There is a problem with this method though. if there is a firewall in between our client and server, this unsolicited connection from the FTP server will likely be blocked by the firewall. This is because, by default, firewalls usually block all incoming connections unless configured otherwise. So the other, more popular option is to use a passive data connection. The way a passive data connection is established is by the client initiating the session, not the server. Randomly generated and agreed source and destination port numbers are used. Because the client initiated the connection internally, the firewall will happily let the traffic pass without blocking it. So now we've seen how FTP works, let's talk about its biggest problem. Because FTP was designed such a long time ago, it lacks even some of the most basic security features we see today, most notably encryption. This means all of our communication between the FTP client and the server is sent in clear text. That includes login credentials and files being transferred. And that is great. Not for us, no. It's great for hackers. Hackers could intercept and steal your login credentials as they're sent to the server. Here's a Wireshark capture of a FTP login. As we can see, the username and password, both of which are cert bros, can be seen in plain text, so very easy for hackers to steal. So why would anyone use FTP if it has such a massive security flaw like plain text transmission? Well, to put it bluntly, you shouldn't. Instead, you should use something called FTPS instead. FTPS, also known as Ftp Secure, is an extension to FTP, adding a layer of security. FTPS uses TLS, which is an encryption protocol used to keep our data safe and away from the prying eyes of hackers. This is what the warning message we saw earlier was telling us about. So, an FTPS connection would look something like this. We connect to our FTP server as before, but this time we negotiate TLS encryption to keep our data safe. Now, encryption is usually described as a tunnel. And by using this tunnel, the hackers can no longer see or steal our data as we send it to the server. And this makes hackers sad. Now, the way TLS negotiations take place and the steps involved will probably need to be covered in a video all of its own. And to be honest, it's probably out of the scope for the CCNA. So for now, just know that the negotiation takes place. Now, you may hear about another protocol called Sftp. And although the name is similar and the purpose of transferring files is the same, Sftp isn't part of the FTP protocol. It's actually part of the SSH protocol, and it uses SSH to securely transfer files. Okay, so the last type of FTP protocol I want to talk about is TFTP. Unlike FTPS, which was an extension of FTP, TFTP kind of goes back the other way. TFTP stands for Trivial File Transfer Protocol, and is pretty much a stripped back version of FTP. To keep it fast and lightweight, TFTP uses UDP port 69. It also doesn't have any of the bells and whistles of standard FTP. Features such as authentication and encryption doesn't exist in TFTP. So then, why would anyone in their right mind want to use TFTP? Well, you definitely don't want to use it over the internet. But where it can be very handy is in a local network for very basic transfers. You could use a TFTP server to quickly backup a Cisco IOS image or a configuration file, for example. Let's jump into a quick TFTP example and see how we can use this to backup a configuration file. First, we're going to need a TFTP server. This computer already has a free TFTP server installed from SolarWinds. As you can see, it's pretty basic, nothing fancy to see here. Okay, so let's say we're doing some work on this router. Maybe we're adjusting the configuration for a new implementation or something along those lines. We want to back up our current configuration. One way to do this is by using our TFTP server. We just simply type copy running -config, and then we type TFTP. it will then ask for the Tftp server IP address. In this case, it's 192.168.0.10. Then it asks us for the file name. It automatically suggests r1-config. Let's keep it as the default and press enter. We get confirmation that the file has been uploaded. Now we have our config backed up, we are free to make any changes we want. In this example, I'll just go into the config mode and change the hostname to something. And I'll hit enter a few times just to confirm the hostname has changed. Right, now let's pretend it's all gone very badly, and we need to restore our config. We can just exit config mode and type copy tftp running config. So this is from the tftp server to our running configuration. Again, it's asking for the IP address of the tftp server. And then the file name to copy. Remember, this was called r1-config. Confirm the destination is the running config. And if we hit enter a few times, we can see our hostname, meaning the configuration, has gone back to normal. Now, of course, we could have just copied the startup config, but this is just one example of the things we can do with Tftp servers. This video is part of the full CCNA course, which can be found in the description, so please feel free to go and check that out. If you like this video, don't forget to give it a thumbs up, leave a comment, and subscribe. The support from you guys really helps this channel grow. Other than that, thank you for watching.